All right, so we're going to wrap up this section today. It's not going to take us all period, so you have some time to start your homework and look at some things. We're going to skip example 16, though. After looking at it, I don't feel like doing it. I don't really think it's necessary, so you just put a big X, okay?
I looked at 17 and 18, and I don't feel like doing those
ones. No, we'll do those. I'm sure you felt that way, too. Okay, we're going to pick up with 17. Before we do, though, little game plan, because I know break is coming. We're going to finish the section today, and then any remaining time, you can work on some homework. Tomorrow will be a free response day. I know it's not Friday, okay, but it will be, oh, I know. free response day, you only have two, because it's a shortened period. When we come back from break, we'll have kind of a review day when the day we come back, and then partner quiz on Wednesday when we come back. So I do want you to realize, though, if you look on page 97, there is a review for the partner quiz. So maybe if you have time and you're not too tired from turkey over break, you can try some of these. Okay, the solutions will be online, so you can check your work. So this partner quiz is going to cover sections 2.3 to 2.4. So those sections were the trig integrals. I will give you the identities. You just have to know how to use them, okay? And then this improper integral section that's been kind of long. So just two sections. So try these out if you can over break. We'll take a look at them together if you have questions when we come back. But a partner quiz on Wednesday, okay? Since we are at the end of the unit, okay, the next page on 99 is the unit review. So we'll be working on that probably, we'll say Thursday and Friday. We'll do 2 days of a review, and then your unit test. I mean, unless you guys don't want to do this, do we not like taking unit tests on Mondays? I know you don't like taking tests in general, but I'm just saying after a weekend. Now, the thing about this test is it's a two-dayer. I know. So one day is multiple choice and one day is free response. Yeah. Let me check. After that, we're done with the unit. Unit two. Yep.
Yeah, I would rather.
No. No one gave you
everything is not.
It's non-calculator. Both days.
Okay, why should I
both?
This is about, I'm actually dropping out this.
No, you're not.
I'm actually doing it this time. So bad.
So here's the thing. We can do 2 days of a review. We can do Thursday, Friday, and then tests would be Monday, Tuesday, the first week in December. It's gonna happen eventually, guys. That is life.
Could we do the test on the Tuesday after, like not the Monday, the Tuesday?
You want 3 days of review?
Yeah, because then if we have questions, we find over the weekend.
Okay.
Because then, if we have questions that we find
over the weekend,
we can review them on Monday and be ready to go.
All right.
Then we all will be sloppy.
Yeah. Okay.
I might not drop the class if we.
You know. I'm going to come home from maternity leave and there's not going to be a class anymore.
It'll just
So, all right. So, finish section today. Free response tomorrow. Review when we come back. Partner quiz Wednesday. Review for unit test Thursday, Friday, Monday. And then unit test Tuesday, Wednesday. Deal?
Deal.
Okay. We can do that. That's what's nice about this class. We kind of have a time luxury, so we're good to go. All right?
So we should just postpone this test.
No. We have the luxury of time, but it's not an infinite amount of time. All right, let's go ahead. Infinity. Fine. Oh, I saw a funny video. If we have time at the end of today, I'll have to show it to you about time and derivatives and graphs and things. It was funny. It's from a comedian, which I wasn't even expecting it. Yo, I don't want to give it away, but I'll show it to you if I can find it. Okay? Let's go ahead and take a look at 17. Find the length of the curve defined by that function from 0 to 2. Have we done this before? Yes, we've done the length of a curve, arc length, definitely. Do we remember the formula?
Yes, 1.3,
yes, arc length. Length of a curve.
Sorry.
It's okay. We fill it in. Length of a curve.
1 plus
Oh. Flamey.
Oh, arc length.
Yep.
The integral on 1 plus the derivative of the square.
All right, there's a little bit more to it.
Square root,
good. And intervals a to b, okay? So we're gonna figure out the length of this curve. So we need to first tackle the derivative and then they would give us the bounds, which are nice. How do you wanna find the derivative of that curve? Do we remember the different names of our shortcuts or derivative rules? Or are they just kind of second nature by now? Can we figure out the derivative? Chain sounds good. Chain rule. Difference of, what do you mean by different? I mean, these are difference of squares, but.
Yeah, I thought the drinking them up was something else. But that's only with the
cubes. Cubes, right? Yeah. Mm-hmm. Let's do chain. So we'll bring down the 1/2, keep the inside, don't forget the new power, times the derivative of the inside.
I don't know why, I don't remember.
The chain? It left? Well, we're going to have to bring that back at some point. We had the power rule. That's kind of the easy one. And then product and quotient, like 1d2 plus 2d1, and then low d high minus high d low, square the bottom, and away you go. And then the chain rule was kind of like the inside-outside stuff. So if you think, we're actually just doing this in Calc 1, so not too off from you guys here. I always think about, kind of sounds like Shrek, but onions. You know how onions have layers?
Yes.
Or gobstoppers, like if you're in a candy mood, okay? So whenever you're doing the chain rule, you're peeling back that onion or layer one derivative at a time. So if you take a look at this function, the outer layer would be the power of a half and kind of the coefficient of one out front. So if you were to find the derivative of that outer layer, you'd have to bring down the 1/2, and then you have to write your new power. But if you're only finding the derivative of the outside layer, you're still left with all of the inside stuff. So that's why we still write it there. So with the 1/2 and the 1 now kind of gone because we took the derivative of that, what would be the derivative of the next layer or the inside stuff? -2x. And you actually multiply each layer at a time in terms of their derivatives. So if we really wanted to step it up, you don't have to write this down, but just as an example. Okay, let's say this was your original function. You could rewrite that as sine of 4x squared. So the outer layer is the power of 2 and kind of the 1 coefficient out front. You would bring down the 2, keep the inner layers, new power would be 1. Now that the 2 is gone, what's the new outer layer? What kind of looks like on the outside of what's left?
Sine.
So we're going to multiply by the derivative of sine, which is cosine, and we're going to keep whatever inside stuff is left there. So with the 2 outer layer gone and the sine outer layer gone, what's the derivative of the next layer? 4 times 4. So in the end, we'd have 8 sine of 4x cosine 4x using the chain rule. You just keep like peeling back those layers from that onion. Okay? So let's go ahead and clean up this derivative. 1/2 times -2, we're left with a negative x, and a negative power can move to the bottom, and we'll make it a root again. So if we fill in that derivative, that's what we have as our arc length integral. And maybe we can clean it up a little bit more, that way it's easier for us. We'll use a calculator for this one because I don't really feel like going backwards by hand. If you square your derivative, negative x squared is a positive x squared. And then if you square your square root in the denominator, we're left with 4 minus x squared. So maybe go ahead and type that in and see what our arc length is. Can you guys kind of think about why this arc length is in this section and not the 1.3 section that we talked about previously this year? Can you determine why this integral is improper? Yeah.
Because if you plug into the numbers.
Right. Okay, notice how this bound, if you were to plug it into your function here, you would have an asymptote somewhere. So this is an improper integral, even though you don't have an infinity somewhere. Okay, so we'll just go ahead and let the calculator do the work. Hopefully, if we plug in 2, it'll give us an answer. But realize if we plug in 2 and it doesn't give us an answer, since there's an asymptote there, we might have to pick some number, not to the right of 2, but to the left of 2, because we're going from 0 to 2. But sometimes if you plug in 2, it will work. We've seen so far that the calculator can be kind of picky or off sometimes, so maybe it will, maybe it won't. Did the calculator spit an answer out yet? Sometimes it takes a little time.
3.142.
Which is roughly pi. Looks good. All right. Let's try the next one. Determine if the integral is convergent or divergent. If it is convergent, find its value. What do you want to try? Do we actually want to go through like the integration and see if we get a number or infinity? Or is there a way we can just look at it right now to determine if it's convergent or divergent? Let's try it. Okay, so if we're going to use P series, okay, if P is less than or equal to 1, what happens? And if P is greater than 1, what happens?
P is less than or equal to 1, it diverges.
Diverges, good. And if it's greater than 1, it converges. Okay. There's a little stipulation though, okay, but.
Hi. Paper,
do you know what? Just leave it on my counter over there and I'll put it up. Is that okay?
Yep.
Okay.
Thank you.
All right. So that's good for us to know about the power. So if we have 1 over x to the power, we can determine convergent or divergent based off the power itself. But what about the bounds? The bounds have to be something too. Mm-hmm. Greater than 0 to some type of infinity. Okay, so at first glance, it looks like this one would be convergent, right? Because our power is greater than 2. But unfortunately, the lower bound is not greater than 0. Okay, so we're not really sure just yet. Okay, so the moral of the story is be careful there. It still might converge, but we're not sure because the bound is a little different.
Now,
so
why do the bounds matter? Because the graph is going to be the same either way, right?
Well, here's the thing. If you...
Because if I just change the lower bound to 1, then you could do it, right? You could do it, right?
Right. So if you... So the moment this graph, 1 over x squared, is rational, at least in the first quadrant, in the second quadrant, it would look like that. If you have something greater than 1, you are physically cutting off this graph at some spot,
yeah.
Right? But the fact that you are including 0 means you have the area is butted up against an asymptote. So you're going to kind of have an infinite area this way as well as an infinite area this way because you're butted up against another asymptote. So since it's 0, we have to figure out that area butted up against the asymptote, is it enough to change the fact that this is convergent to divergent? Because we're adding more area in there. Is that more area significant or not? That's what we're going to try to figure out. Okay, because if it's greater than 0, you're cutting it off. But if it's on 0, you have more area to take into account. Does that make sense? Okay. So what we actually have to do for this one, unfortunately, since it doesn't fit the P series kind of setup exactly, we're actually going to have to do this one backwards by hand. Okay, but I think we can do that because we can just simply rewrite it as x to the negative second. So again, if you're not sure if something converges or diverges just by looking at it, or maybe even doing that comparison that we've talked about, you can always try to do the integral by hand to see if you get a number or to see if you get infinity. So if we work backwards, we'd have negative 1 x to the negative first. We can rewrite it as negative 1 over x. If you plug in infinity, negative 1 over infinity, negative 1 over something huge, 0. And then we have to subtract. Now remember, we have some type of asymptote going on here because we cannot physically plug in zero, right? So we got to think of something very, very close to zero, but from the right-hand side, because we're going from zero to infinity. So something really, really, really close to zero would be like 0.0000001. And if you did negative 1 divided by 0.0000001, that'd be a really large number, right? So we're subtracting a negative large number. So subtracting a very negative large number would end up being a very positive number. So based on that integral result, we can define it as divergent. All right, so moral of the story, I think we kind of briefly mentioned this before. It looks like P series at first glance, okay, because we have 1 over x to a power. And just by looking at 2, you might think it converges. But the bounds are important, because notice how this one diverges. Okay, if it was anything bigger than 0, it would converge. But somehow that area butted up against the asymptote is significant, because if we keep adding it, we're going to have an infinite amount of area. Okay, so moral of the story, be careful with the bounds. All right, let's try this last one. I think this is kind of interesting. At least I hope you guys feel the same way. We'll see if I blow your mind at the end. So we're going to let f of x be 1 over x, and we're specifically looking at the interval from 1 to infinity. We're going to let R be the region in the first quadrant. So we have a little diagram here. If you were to think about drawing this graph 1 over x, you would have that rational shape. And we're going to cut it off at 1, and we're going towards infinity. So this is the area that we're trying to visualize. But if we were to take that area and revolve it, can you see how you would generate that horn shape based off the picture? If you take that area and move it in a circle, you'd kind of generate a horn. Okay, so this is what's known as Gabriel's horn, or I think it's pronounced Torricelli's trumpet, either one of those. So let's go ahead and figure out the volume of this horn. Okay, how much water in whatever unit, like cubic feet, cubic inches, cubic centimeters, whatever, could you fill it? So volume is the integral of what? How do we figure out volume? You integrate the area. And if we're rotating it, we're doing an area of a circle. So we need pi times the radius squared. The radius of your circle, if you look at your diagram, is just the little triangle you draw from the function to the x-axis. Okay, what you're revolving around. So that would just be the 1 over x function. And bounds are from 1 to infinity. All right, so if we check it out, we have pi times the integral of 1 to infinity. We have 1 over x squared. We can bring that up and make it a negative power if we wanted to. All right, how about we do this? I mean, you can keep it as 1 over x squared for now, but take a look at this. We have 1 over x squared, and our integral is from 1 to infinity. Do we already know if we should be converging or diverging?
Yes.
Yes, we should be what?
Diverging. No,
converging. We have a P series with a power of 2, and notice how the bound is 1 to infinity, something greater than 0. So we already know we're converging. We should get a numbered value, but we're actually going to figure out what that is. Okay, so at least we know we should get something in the end here. If we work backwards, we'll have negative 1 over x. Okay, very similar to the last one we just did. So if we plug in infinity, negative 1 over infinity is practically 0 times pi. Going to be 0. And if we subtract what we get when we plug in 1, we'll have negative 1 times pi, which is negative pi. So it looks like that finite volume that we calculated should be pi. Okay, so we converged. We got a numbered answer in the end. So you can fill this horn with pi cubic units of water, whatever unit it might be. Okay, let's check out now surface area. Now we haven't really talked about this and we're not going to. I'm just bringing it up to show you something interesting here. So the surface area integral calculation I gave you, let's go ahead and see if we can figure this out. Our bounds are still 1 to infinity. We need pi times the function, which was 1 over x. And then it looks like we kind of have that arc length integral portion showing up too. So we need 1 plus the derivative squared. Can we figure out the derivative of the 1 over x function? Maybe you want to do quotient rule, low, d high, minus high, d low. Square the bottom and away you go. Maybe you want to rewrite it as x to the negative first and do the power rule. Either one of those. The derivative, the antiderivative of 1 over x is natural log. But we gotta figure out the derivative of 1 over x. You could. Okay, so if you rewrote 1 over x as x to the negative first and use the power rule, that'd be negative x to the negative second. We can go ahead and type that in there, or write that in there. All right, I want you to use your calculator for this one. Now, I know you can't physically plug in infinity, but maybe just use a really, really big number and see what you get. Is your calculator still thinking?
Yes.
Yeah. No? What'd you get?
43.75%.
What was your upper bound?
A million.
A million. Okay. So my upper bound, mine's still thinking. I'm trying a bigger number, but.
Mine said tolerance not met.
Tolerance not met. So that's too high. Like the value is too big. See, mine says the same thing. Tolerance not met. So the number is so big that your calculator can't literally, right, your calculator can't tolerate it. Okay, total or tolerance not met. So notice how initially, I know you can't see it, but in this first one I did, my upper bound was 1,000 and I got 29.3. Eric's was 1,000,000 and he got 40 some, right? 40. Right, so if you keep going and going, the value is going to get higher and higher, maybe slowly, but it's eventually, it's still getting higher and higher. And I have no idea what that number is, but the tolerance wasn't met. So this is signifying some type of infinite value. So can you comprehend what this is telling us? Yeah. So somehow this trumpet type shape, you are able to physically fill it with X amount of water, specifically pi amount, whatever cubic units you want to use. But if you tried to paint the outside of the horn, you would never ever have enough paint to do so.
Doesn't.
It's infinite. Can you wrap your mind around that? Mind blown? Okay? Absolutely not, right? Magic of math. So somehow this horn, you can fill it with a finite amount of water, but you will never ever be able to use enough paint to paint the outside of it.
That's a special horn.
I know it is. It's Gabriel's horn. Weird, right? All right. So both of those were concepts involving these improper integrals. Notice how we had the bounds to infinity. So interesting tidbit there. Volume versus surface area, at least for this example. Okay, really weird. Okay, it's some type of paradox. All right, so that was just something interesting to end on for that section. We still have about 10 minutes left if you want to try to tackle some homework problems. I would say before test time at some point. So, I mean, we're having our partner quiz on the Wednesday we get back, but if we're not having the test until the following Tuesday, you can keep working on it if you need time. Okay, I would say just before test. Okay? And I'll make sure the odd solutions are online so you can check your work as you go.
Can you show us that video?
Yes, let me try to find it.